Yes, to be frank, military reform was very challenging at that time. Not easy, but we have to do it. Now, firstly, we have to define the ultimate objective. What are the goals and why military reforms should be conducted? And I remember when leading a team to draw the blueprint and roadmap of the military reform, I set clear objectives. Number one, the military must stop playing politics, practical politics. Number two, the military must respect democracy, support democracy. So with that, we had to win the so-called internal acceptance and internal support. So I talked to all generals, Army, Navy, Air Force, that we have to change. What kind of change? I explained the objectives, the step to be taken, the roadmap, and also the blueprint. And I was so happy because 70% of the generals and high-ranking officers support the idea of reforms. Next, I have to talk to the reformists, to the civil society. Please give us a time to change, to prepare our change, because the reform must be having clear objectives, must be well managed, and the agenda must also be clear. And after around 1 year time, by very intensive works, day and night, so finally we did our reforms. And later on, when I left my military career, I entered politics and became president of Indonesia. My task is to safeguard, to ensure that the military reform will go ahead and reach the overall objective that we had, that we have set up before. So the story of our reform, and with that, the military is not only supporting the national reform, but we were part of the reform. We were part of the solution. And even we could say to the elements of old regime, look, we have reformed ourselves. We could do it. Why don't we work together to reform our country for the better future, more democratic and more people-oriented? Yes, yes, Islam actually must be fully understood by friends around the globe, because Islam is misunderstood by non-Islam and by Islam itself. So talking about what is the relation between Islam and democracy, or it is Islam compatible with democracy? So I have to say that there are Islamic values that, in my view, are compatible with the democratic values. For example, Islam, by our teaching, love of peace, love justice, love consensus building, love prosperity, love equality. And those are actually also democratic values. So we try to convince our Muslim, our Ummah, look, our values are very much similar to democratic values. That's number one. Number two, my friend, in Indonesia, I think more than 40% of our political parties are Islamic-based political parties. It means the idealism, the ideology is Islam. But the respect universal values, the respect nation state, not borderless Islamic world, their platform also quite relevant to the national agenda, the national policy. So we could say to the people, look, our Islamic political parties are part of the democracy itself. So why don't we do things that not to contradict Islam and democracy? And of course, like many other Islamic countries, there are elements of hardliners, of the radicals, and for that, and I have to say, they say that, well, Islam is not compatible with democracy, but the number is small, so it is becoming the duties and the responsibility of the religious leaders, of moderate Islamic leaders, to talk to their followers, to talk to the ummah that, well, Islam is compatible with a democracy. And with that, actually, as it is proven by Indonesia, now there's no problem at all. Democracy can be well applied in our politics, in our system. So there are many approaches that we could do to ensure that there is a good harmony between Islam and democracy. And it works in Indonesia. Yes, well, ASEAN now consists of 10 member countries, and ASEAN, to be frank, varies in terms of the ideologies, system, political system, I mean. We need to accept that reality. Firstly, ASEAN must be able to work together while respecting the diversity among the member countries. But there is a historic moment for ASEAN when we were able to renew our charter, the ASEAN charter. Mm-hmm. And then the new charter, and I have involved personally, it is now clearly stated that ASEAN respect democracy, respect rule of law, respect human rights. I think it is a dramatic achievement that we could do by having new charter of ASEAN. But of course, remember, among us, the member of ASEAN, some of us are having the communist ideology, centralism, some are exercising authoritarian or semi-authoritarian type government, some one of our members monarchy in its political systems, and some exercising democratic values. So even though we have our charter with the respect for democracy, human rights, and rule of law, I think I personally understand that we need transition. I do believe that someday all countries will fully respect democracy, rule of law, and human rights, then probably they will adopt that kind of values. That is the success of how ensuring ASEAN to really accept democratic values.